Praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great.
You to join in as well. Gracious and most heavenly Father, we thank you today, for this is truly a day that you've made, Lord God, and we choose to rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to worship you. Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to gather together as believers and lift up the mighty name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you are welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. We thank you for your presence today. We thank you for what you're going to do today. And we give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. Do we have any first-time visitors this morning? Praise God for you. We would show love, but due to COVID, we're just going to love on you, give you a love offering. we thank you. And as we often say, in place of our pastor, James Maurice, and Lady Trenise, just don't make this your last time visiting with us. We love on each other at Rose Hill Church of Port Allen. And because of you, the atmosphere has already shifted. We thank the people that invited you. And we encourage all of our members to invite people to Christ. Invite them to worship. If you're blessed, invite others to come and be blessed as well. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
This is a special time in our service that has been set aside for giving. For we know that it's more blessed to give than to receive. So if you're in the building and in need of an envelope, our ushers would gladly give you one. And there are many different ways that you can give. If you don't have the envelope, you can Cash App, you can text to give, online. We sure don't want you to miss out either. There are many different ways that you can give. Once you have your envelopes ready, I ask that you lift them to heaven for me this morning. Father God, we thank you for the gifts this morning. We thank you for the seeds that are being planted, Lord God. And I ask that you bless not just the seeds, but even the giver of the seeds, Lord God, that they will not suffer any lack for what they're giving. Lord, we thank you. And for those who wanted to give and don't have it, Lord, we ask that you bless them. So the next time that the invitation is given to give, Lord God, that they will too be blessed. We thank you. Amen.
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 Would you pass your givens down?
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good. Yes, he is good.
And again, I would like to thank everyone for their giving. Are you ready for a word this morning?
Hallelujah.
Are you sure you're ready for a word this morning? Well, after the next selection from the praise team, I will come back to give you the word. And I ask that you pray with me and that you pray for me so that God will use me in a mighty way this morning, so that the word will not just touch your ears, but they'll touch your heart.
Amen.
And compel you to do things differently.
Amen.
I'm coming to encourage you. So as the praise team lead us further in worship, I ask that you encourage me by praying for me.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we were able to come in and enter into your presence, Lord, because you were already in the place. Lord, we thank you for setting the atmosphere this morning.
Hallelujah.
To be conducive for your spirit, oh
yes,
Lord.
Yes, hallelujah.
Father God, we thank you for your children. Those that are in the building and those that are online, Lord God, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
For a word. And Lord, at this very moment, I decrease so that you may increase, God. Have your way.
Yes.
I'll open my mouth, but you speak.
Lord,
I ask that you minister to me.
Hallelujah.
While you minister through me. Lord, allow your children's heart to be the ground on which your word falls this morning. Lord, we need a touch.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
A touch like never before. Lord, because you allowed your darling son Jesus to die in our place.
Yes, hallelujah.
And he got up. Lord, we too can get up from whatever situation we are in. With all power in our hand, declaring victory is mine.
Hallelujah.
Victory is ours. Lord, we're no longer the victims. Lord, we're victorious because of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the victory. No matter what we're facing and no matter what we're going through, we're already victorious. And because of that, Father God, we give you the glory. We give you the honor.
Hallelujah.
And we give you the praise that you're so deserving of. Lord, we just thank you this morning. Lord, we praise you this morning because you're great and you're greatly to be praised. Lord, we magnify the name of Jesus. Lord, we allow everything in our lives to decrease so that you may increase. Lord, have your way, God. We need you. We desire you. Lord, we want you. Less of us. And more of you.
Yes,
less of us and more of you. Have your way, God. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. This morning's scripture reading will be coming from Isaiah, the 30th chapter and the 18th verse. And it reads, "Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. Therefore, he will rise up to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait on him." You may be seated in the presence of the Most High God. Would you give our praise team another round of applause? For truly, y'all have blessed me this morning. With everything going on in the world today, anxiety is at an all-time high. Or is it just me? Everybody just anxious. They want everything done in a hurry. And sometimes it's not just us. We have deadlines that we have to meet. There are things that requires immediate attention. And with all of that going on, I don't find it strange. Why? Because whatever God wants us to do, the enemy always wants the opposite. So because God tells us to be still and wait, you know there's always someone tugging, hurry up, you don't have time. You need to do it in a hurry. He doesn't want us to receive the blessings that God has for us. But God said, "Blessed are those who wait on me." And even in your weakness, even in the times that you're weak, God said that he'll renew your strength. He said, for those that wait on the Lord, he said, I will renew your strength. Does anyone need renewed strength this morning? Well, let me speak to your strength this morning, that it will be renewed because you're going to wait. My prayer is today that you wait not just on me, but you wait with me. We're going to wait together because it's good to learn to wait, even when you go to a doctor's appointment. And you get to your doctor's appointment, and you're anxious to find out what's wrong or what your results are. When you go to the window and you sign in, there's something called a waiting room. You have to learn to wait. Even though you made your appointment at 10 o'clock, you may not be seen at 10 o'clock. You have to learn to wait. But in order to wait, we have to learn to be patient. Patience is a fruit of the Spirit. And we have to learn to be patient to wait. What I love about God is when we're connected to him and he's the tree that our fruit are produced from, he don't expect us to do anything on our own. Because what happens is the tree is already being nourished by him. So everything that we need, we can get from the tree. So if our trees are going to produce fruits of the Spirit, then every fruit that's on the tree, he will equip us to be able to go further with those fruits. So patience is a fruit. And we need to be patient in order to wait on God. There are so many blessings that are awaiting us, but we must be willing to do the work to receive those blessings. Moving and doing things at a fast pace will cause us to tire out really quick. And then we become frustrated. And we begin to make decisions that really don't even make sense when we look back at them. So what we have to do is find rest. How do you find rest? You find rest in God. So the enemy's job is to make us weak. Remember that all throughout my message. But God said we can rely on him to be our strength. Philippians 4, 6 through 7 says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." In doing this, we must be strengthened and get positioned to receive what God has in store for us. The fact that we aren't expected to do it on our own is what gives me hope, and I pray that it gives you hope too. He never expects us to do anything on our own. He tells us to lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge God, and he will direct your path. That means don't you even think about it. Say, this ain't even my battle. I don't have to think about it. I don't even have to concern myself with it. I'm going to lean and depend on God and his understanding and allow the Holy Spirit to do it for me. The reason you become tired, anxious and frustrated is because you're trying to do it on your own. Who better could he use to give you this message but me? One who was never willing to wait. Everything I got, I needed it in a hurry. I was the prodigal daughter. They talk about the prodigal son in the Word. I was the prodigal daughter. I wasn't waiting because that take too long. So I'm going to hurry up. But when I became a new creature in Christ, and I allowed the presence of God to be what I strive for and to get in his presence and allow him to speak to me and deal with me, then he was able to show me some things that I couldn't see before. So that's what the enemy wants to do. He wants to have you so busy till you don't have time to talk to God. I need to make a decision now. Who has time to pray? I don't have time to pray. I got to do it now. Who has time to wait? I need to do it now. Do you know that we are graced to wait? We're in a series about grace. And all year, we've been talking about different things that we're graced for, different types of grace. Do you know that we are graced to wait? Which is the title of today's message. It's the love of God for me, though. It's the love that God has for me that shows me many things that I couldn't see before. As I reflect on all that the Lord has done, I realize how much he really loved me. You come to church Sunday after Sunday. You've heard your parents and your grandparents and everybody say this, but do you really know personally how much God loves you? A mother or a father with one child probably knows, but there are other people who don't have children. You should know too. God had a son. He was willing to give the one son he had to die in our place. Not while we were saved, while we were yet sinners. Knowing that we would even sin against him and not trust him and doubt him and not believe him. He loved us so much that he gave his son to die in our place so we wouldn't have to go through the turmoil that he went through. That's love. To give your only son who knew no sin to die for us while we were yet sinners, that speaks volume to me. Then to know that the same love he had then, he still have today. So after all you've done, after all I've done, after all the choices I made intentionally or unintentionally, you mean I serve a God that loved me anyway? I serve a God that's willing to forgive me for my wrong when I knew better and still chose to do it? Yes, I came to serve you. Notice, he still loves you that much. So if love is what you're seeking, I invite you to accept God's love this morning. Romans 5 and 8 says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Getting in the presence of God allows his love to show us, and accepting it is what's needed for us to wait on him. The more he shows us how faithful he is and how trustworthy he is, the more confident we can become in him, which requires relationship. To know someone is one thing, but to have a relationship with them is something totally different. You may know my name. You may know my history. You may know all about me. But to have relationship with me is really to know me. And that's how God wants us to be with him. Not just to know God, but to have relationship with him. Because when you have a relationship with someone, you long to be in their presence. You desire to be with them and around them, and then you can get the benefits out of the relationship. Psalms 26 and 3 says, for thy loving kindness is before mine eyes, and I have walked in the truth. See, others may let you down with a lie. They may tell you they love you and then show you something different. But God is not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he should even have to repent. Do you know that nowhere you go or nothing you do can change God's love for you? It's nothing you can work for. It's nothing you can do. It's nothing you can say. He loves all of us the same. So that means no matter where you grew up, no matter what type of education you have, no matter the color of your skin, no matter your sex, none of that matters. No matter what's on your background, what's on your credit report, he loves all of us the same. And I'm grateful for that, because if some of those things I mentioned was a requirement, I would have missed the mark. Psalms 36 and 5 says, your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the skies. The second point I want to make is long. No matter who you are or what you've done, you serve a God that longs to meet you right where you are. To long means to desire, to go after. He's knocking on the door of your heart even today. He longs to have relationship with you. You're in a hurry for everything else. Are you in a hurry for God? Ask yourself, are you in a hurry to spend time with him? Are you in a hurry to hear what he has to say about the matter that you're facing? Psalms 14 and 2 said, the Lord looks down from heaven on the children of man to see if there are any who understand and who would seek after him. While he's looking down from heaven, will he see you seeking to understand him? Will he see you? He is quietly beckoning you with his love. Simply speaking, don't shut me out. Please let me in. The dark place, the secret place, let me in. Allow me to come in and dine and sup with you. Let me in. God has an incredible life filled with an ever-increasing awareness of his love for you. He longs for your heart to be wrapped up in his presence when the world rejects you, when they speak lies about you, when they try to pull you away from the comfort of his love and peace. He longs for you. Revelations 3 and 20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him and he with me. May we be a people who center our lives around God's longing to be encountered. May we all seek to be wherever he is. God doesn't want us to wrestle. I don't know about you, but I've been wrestling lately with some stuff. He said, daughter, I don't want you to wrestle. I just need you to wait. If I said it in my word, you need to know that I watch over my word to perform it. So what are you wrestling for? Why are you wrestling with that situation when all I need you to do is wait? What you need is found in my word. And if I give it to you in my word, I just need you to wait on it to manifest itself. When we become weary, though, he offers us a way of escape because he longs to be with us. Matthew 11, 28 through 29 says, "Come to me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto my souls." So once we've learned to accept God's love and realize that God longs to be with us, something else must take place. We have to learn how to let go and let God. I'm going to say that again. We have to learn how to let go and let God. It comes a time when we must let go of any and everything that's holding us back from where God wants us to be. We have to be still and let God do what's best because he knows what's best for us. Oftentimes, it's us and our old mindsets that are the problem. Knowing now how much God loves us and how he longs to show us compassion, we must get out of the way and let God have his way. We must let go and let God. Exodus 14 and 14 says, "The Lord will fight for you. You need only be still." The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. To be still requires you to wait. Why are you fighting battles that were never intended for you to fight? You're not strong enough to fight them, even if you think you are. He said we have to be still. He is going to fight for us. I don't know about y'all, but I'm tired. I don't have the strength that I used to have. Back in the day, I fight at the drop of a dime. But I realize that I'm not fighting against flesh and blood. What we're trying to fight is not even a fight that's intended for us. We're fighting against things that we shouldn't be fighting against. He said, just be still. He graced us to be still. As children of the Most High God, we no longer have to try to make things happen. The song told us before I begin to minister, victory is already ours. Why are you working so hard for something that's already yours? He said, just do what I called you to do. Victory is already yours. So when defeat show up, you have to tell defeat, victory is already mine. Jesus already conquered that. I just had to show up. I don't have to fight. I had to show up, but I don't have to fight. We have the luxury of letting things happen by trusting, leaning, and depending on God. When we find ourselves in position that require immediate attention, we don't have to become frustrated or anxious, but instead pray in faith because our Father will come to our rescue. Have you ever been in a situation where you thought you knew the answer? Only to find out the answer you had was not the right answer. And then he showed up anyhow. I don't know about you, but I love them anyhow blessings. I told you to be still and you went and did what you wanted, but I'm going to bless you anyhow. You have to learn to be patient and wait on God. Psalms 34 and 17 said, "The righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all of their troubles." Who wouldn't serve a God like that? Not only do he hear you when you cry out, but he promised to deliver us out of it all. So deliverance is already ours. So all you have to do is know you're delivered even before you go in a thing. No longer declare bondage. You're not bound. You're delivered by the grace of God. Letting go is not a sign of weakness, but it's a sign of strength. It takes trust. You have to put all that you have in your hands today, right now. You have to put it in God's hand. Things like your family, your children, your marriage, your money, your education, your health, your career. You have to put it in God's hand. Because if you hold it too long, you're going to taint it. Just give it to God. Release it unto God and then wait on him to tell you the next move to make. God is not just someone else. He's Lord. So you can trust him with all of those things that I named, no matter how precious they are to you. Because you and those things are even more precious to him than they are to you. He is Lord, and because he is Lord, we can depend on him at all times. Letting go and letting God sounds easy, but it requires our faith, and our faith will be worked. I can rest assured that our work will pay off, though. 2 Chronicles 15:7 says, "Be ye strong, therefore, and let not your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded." First, we receive God's love. And in receiving God's love, we understand that God longs for us to be in relationship with him. And when we get the analogy that God longs for us to be in relationship with him, we become free enough to let go and let God. But all of this is a learning process. In surrendering our will and letting God's will for our lives be done, we will receive instructions from him. The instructions that we receive must be applied, and how well we listen and the notes that we take will determine what we've learned. Each person in this room, I'm sure, at some point in life has been to school. Just because you show up for class don't mean you learned anything. God said, just because you hear my word still don't mean you've learned anything. But faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So my prayer is that you learn of him as you hear the word, and then you utilize the things that you've learned. If faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, faith is the way we're going to have to do things in life, then God needs to know if you learned something. So I encourage you to spend time with him, sup and dine with him so you can learn of him. Psalms 32:8 said, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you." So he don't just lead you to the wolves. He watches you the whole time. What I love about him is if you don't learn it the first time, he'll give you a chance to learn it again. You're going to keep taking the test until you pass it. The blessing is in knowing that God is going to be with you every time. Every time the test may be harder, but God has all power in his hands. So don't be afraid about the test that you have to take. When you learn something, nobody can take away knowledge that you have. I know him for myself. If he delivered me last time, he'll deliver me this time. If he brought me through this, then he will bring me through that. If he told me my children were blessed, I'm believing they're blessed regardless as to what they're looking like. If he paid the bill off last time, he'll pay it off this time. If he gave me favor with man last time, he'll give me favor with man this time. You learn something, and when you learn something, nobody can take away the knowledge that you have. Their story may not be your story, but I know what he did for me, and I ask that you keep that in your heart. If you know what he did last time, know that he's the same God now. He never changes. It looked impossible last time, but we serve a God that specializes in the impossible. It looked like he wasn't going to come through last time, but he came through. So if you just wait on him, what do you think would happen? If you stop moving ahead of him and say, "Lord, this time, I'm going to wait on you. I might not have as much debt as I had the last time if I wait. I might not have to go through some of the heartache if I just wait. I may really be able to see your favor and your glory in this if I would just wait." Stepping out on faith can be more peaceful than you imagine. When we step out on our own, we have no idea what we'll have to face. But when we step out on the foundation of the word of God, the Lord sets a place in which he will guarantee us victory, not sometimes, but every time. Philippians 4:9 says, "Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you." You mean to tell me when I walk in God's way, I even find peace? He said, my peace I leave with you. So I don't have to be anxious. I can wait on him and then wait in peace. And then receive my blessings in peace. Can I tell you this morning that peace in itself is a blessing? With all of the drama and conflama that's going on, I'm at a point in my life where peace really needs to be still. When you have a peace within, you'll learn that that's the best peace you can have. Because regardless as to what's going on around you, you can be at peace with it. I've learned to be at peace while I wait. Everything is going on. The tears are rolling. All kind of chaos. But yet I got peace. How do I find it? When I call on the name of Jesus. Because what I see ain't lining up with what you say. Please, Lord, give me peace. If at any point in time you feel overwhelmed, you can call on God too. We don't have to doubt him in any way or rely on ourselves in any situation. But we can connect with God through prayer, knowing that he will not just answer us, but he'll teach you some things in prayer. It requires you, though, being still and waiting. Prayer is a line of communication. Do you know that one of the most frustrating things is to talk to somebody and all they do is talk, but they never give you a chance to talk? Does that resemble your prayer life? That you just talk to God, but you never sit still enough to hear from him. Just talk. A conversation is best had when one person talks and the other one listens. And then when the other one is talking, the other person listens. That's what God asks of us. He says, sit in my presence and be still. You talk to me and I'll talk to you. It's oftentimes we're though in a hurry that we tell God, I need this and I need that and thank you for this and thank you for that, but we're never still enough to see what else he have to say. He said, while you were thanking me for that, I was already planning this. While you were asking me for that, I already saw this. So if we learn to be still in God's presence, not only can you tell him how you feel, you allow him to show you how he feel. Psalms 24 and 5 says, show me your ways, Lord, and teach me your paths. Have you been going down the wrong path lately? Been finding yourself at a dead end? Maybe not, y'all. Maybe it's just me. I had to ask God to show me his ways. He said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. And my ways are not your ways. But if you be still in my presence, he said, I'll lead you and I will direct your path. Lord, it's so amazing. God can use just what the devil intended for harm to work for your good. He knew that all of his children were different. And any parent we have in the room or online that have children, you know that your children are different. Even in our minister class, Pastor gave an analogy that really blessed me. As our spiritual father, he knows each one of his children. So he set different expectations for each one of his children. Where you are today didn't find God by surprise. He knew that you would be right where you are today. I'm so glad that for children like me who were ADD and ADHD, when it came to God and his grace, that he favored me. He knew that I would be anxious. He knew that I would move ahead of him. But he's such an awesome, amazing, and forgiving God that he met me right where I was. He even said that laughter was the best medicine. So for me to stand before you crying, I don't want you to be moved by my tears. They're actually tears of joy. Because if truth be told, I didn't want to wait for my time to come. I really wanted the time to pass me by. But he said, no, I can't use you to speak to my people until I show you what I'm doing. God said he's graced us to wait. The blessing is in the waiting. He knew that his children were different, and he kept us on his mind all at the same time. Some are willing to wait because anxiety is not a problem. But we're facing so much in the world today that so many people that I talk to are on all different kinds of anxiety medicine. Can I tell you there's no medicine greater than the Word of God? There's no medicine that's going to heal you like the Word of God. God is the great physician. Spending time with God is what helped me to realize that waiting can truly be a blessing. Just as the prodigal son wanted it then, and I stated that about me earlier, so many others are just like that. But God doesn't hold it against us. We have done things in our way because we didn't understand his timing, and we didn't feel that time was on our side. But now that we're in a better place, we are all going to do better. Making moves and decisions may still come from every direction, back to back, but you no longer have to be anxious. We just have to be understanding and know that God has graced each and every one of us to wait. God is repositioning you right now. Get ready to wait. Don't lose faith in your waiting. Start handling things differently and see how God blesses you. Remembering one thing, victory means you don't win sometimes. Victory means we win all the time. So for all of the victorious people under the sound of my voice, I ask that you stand on your feet and give God a round of applause for victory in our way.
Yeah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Victory in our waiting. Father God, we thank you today.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
That you graced us to wait on you. So, Lord, we dare not to move before you, but to wait on you, God. Lord, we thank you for your word today as it has gone forth. Lord, I pray that your word was a blessing to your people. God, continue to do your work in, with, and through us. Lord, we glorify you. We magnify you. And we know that the wait will be worth it. If there's anyone in the place today under the sound of my voice that has fallen away from the faith, we encourage and invite you to come back today. We give you an invitation to come. Lord, we thank you. For those who do not know you, God, in the parts of their sin, we invite you to come today. We invite you to Christ. For those who are in a backslidden state and have fallen away from God, I need you to know that he welcomes you. For that prodigal son, for that prodigal daughter who moved too fast and thought they could do it on their own, he calls you home. He awaits you. If there's anyone who's looking for a church home, Rose Hill Church of Port Allen is an amazing place to be grounded and rooted. We invite you today. At this time, I ask that if anyone accept that invitation, that you'll wave your hand in the place. You accept God for the first time. If you're looking for a church home, if you're falling away and want to return, we ask that you wave your hand this time and I'll pray for you and with you.
Healing is here.
Amen.
Joy is here.
It's in the room.
It's in.
Don't take this moment for granted. Whatever you need is in the room today. Joy, peace, love, salvation is here today. If you're watching online or even if you're in the building, you know God is speaking to your heart, don't let this moment pass you by. It's important that we seize the moment. What we have to realize is that this moment may not happen again. So what that means is don't take this moment for granted. I'm not trying to put fear in your heart, but things are happening all around us quickly. There was a time you could say be here today, gone tomorrow. You can be here today and gone today. Amen.
Amen.
So if God has graced you with an opportunity to get in a better relationship with him, don't take this moment for granted. You need to rededicate yourself. Listen, he says, my sheep know my voice.
Yeah,
my sheep know my voice. Behold, he says, I stand at the door and I knock. But he's such a gentleman that he won't rush into your life like the thief. The thief come to steal, kill, and destroy. But he says, no, I want you to want me like I want you. And you open up and let me come in and I'll sup with you. Yeah, that's relationship. That's what God desires. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what you've said before you got here. This moment is precious. Yeah. He's speaking to your heart, even in this moment. Yes. Father, touch their hearts even right now. Can I ask that you repeat after me? Dear Lord God.
Dear Lord God.
Today.
Today.
I'm your child.
I'm your child.
I believe.
That Jesus Christ.
Is the Son of God.
Is the Son of God.
And that he died.
And that he died.
And you raised him.
And you raised him.
From the dead.
From the dead.
I confess. Every sin.
Every shortcoming.
I repent. Come into my heart.
Be Lord of my life.
Today.
Today.
This day.
My life.
Shall never be the same.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Come on, bless the Lord on today. Yeah, I wanted to do that to make sure that I have a peace. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Did you enjoy the word today?
Amen.
Come on, can you bless God for Minister Baptiste? Amen.
Amen.
Grace to wait. And listen, even in that waiting, it's not that you're just being still, immobile, right? Yeah, it's action. Because even when you're waiting, you continue to serve because you trust the God that you're waiting on.
Yeah.
Amen. Most time people hear that word waiting, they just think I'm going to sit and wait. No, waiting is action. It means to serve, really. Yeah, you go to a restaurant, you have a waitress or a waiter, and they serve you, right? And how they serve determines how you give them a tip, right? Yeah, you know how it goes. Some of you don't tip right. Y'all know that. They don't bring your napkin. You mad. You don't give them a tip. Amen. But when you wait on the Lord, God gives you a blessing that no man could ever give you. You hear me? Come on, bless the Lord on today. Thank you for the gift. Thank you for the ministry gift. Hey, how are you? You good? Come see. Stretch out your hands. Father, we pray even now in the name of Jesus. I plead the blood over his life. I bind the hand of the enemy even now and declare that this life you can't have.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Satan, he belongs to God. And no weapon formed against him shall prosper. Yeah, I know you're trying to take him out, but we plead the blood now. Hey, hallelujah.
The blood of Jesus
be over his life. I thank you, God, for what you're doing. The work you've begun in him, God. The enemy is trying to distract him, God. But you made a promise just as he made a promise to you, God. Cover him. Protect him. Keep his mind, in perfect peace, oh God. As it stays on you, God. I thank you right now, God, that the weapons of his warfare, they're not carnal. They're mighty through you, God. So the pulling down of strongholds. We pull down every stronghold right now. In the name of Jesus. We cast it down to the pits of hell from which it came. We speak your peace and calmness to his mouth. Direct his path, oh God. Order his steps, I pray, in the name of Jesus. thank you for this moment. Thank you, God, that he was willing to even walk up at this moment, oh God, in the name of Jesus. I thank you for his life. We speak blessings over him now in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 You may be seated. Listen, thank you so much for all of you who are here. Any first-time visitors, anyone visiting with us for the first time, amen. Bless God for you. Won't put a mic, anything in your hand. Bless you. Thank you so much for being here. Listen, our service has been enhanced just by your mere presence. There's only one favor we ask of you, that you don't make this your last time fellowshipping with us. Come on, can we bless God for our visitors? Amen. We bless and thank God for you. Thank you so much. Listen, on next Sunday, we will have a special guest. One of my sisters, she's coming from Houston, Texas. Her husband and her started a ministry a few years ago called Chase Visions. And my wife and myself had a chance to go be with them earlier this year at a conference they had. And so we're inviting her down. And she's not coming empty-handed. I'm telling you, she's going to come with a crew, so. We bless God for her, and I believe that God is going to speak through her to minister to our hearts like he's done on today. Amen.
Amen.
I enjoyed the word today. Did you enjoy the
Amen.
Word? So Quincy and Sabrina Chase will be with us on next week, and we want you to be praying for them. And also, I want us to always be mindful. I said it, and I keep saying it. Enjoy life. Don't take life for granted. You hear me? God's grace is available to you. So every moment you have to enjoy your family, to enjoy your friends, to enjoy your loved ones, do just that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Don't major in the minor stuff. I know there's so much going on, and sometimes we focus on negative stuff, the little simple stuff. We forgot to take the trash out. Now you're not speaking to me. And all kind of foolish stuff that means nothing. I'll get the trash. I'll get the trash. Amen. Just love on one another while we can. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I really believe that the angel, the death angel, is trying to creep around us. But I plead the blood of Jesus over our lives today.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah, we apply the blood. No weapon formed against us is going to prosper. Amen. Amen. And don't forget to join us this coming Wednesday for Word Wednesday, virtual only. Word Wednesday is virtual only. And we thank God for our ministers. They've been giving me a chance to rest. And we're definitely appreciative for that. Amen. But I'll be back with you as soon as I get powered up. Amen. Thank God that we do have ministers that are equipped to bring the word and can give us an opportunity to rest and come back before you. I always say, don't get caught up in the messenger. If you're hungry for the word, then you come seeking the word. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we bless God one more time for your ministry gift. Come on, bless God one more time for Minister Baptiste. Come on, stand to your feet. Just look at your neighbor. Don't hug him or anything. Just look at him and say, hey, good to see you. Bless God for you. Thank you so much for being here. Come on, receive minister for our benediction.
Again, I would like to thank Pastor Maurice and Lady Trenise for giving me the opportunity to speak to the men, women, and children of God. I pray again that you were blessed by the word. Please bow your heads before we dismiss. Father God, we thank you for such an amazing word. We thank you for your presence. And Lord, we ask that you be with us, not just now, but even as we go throughout next week, next month, even the next couple of hours, minutes. We thank you for your presence. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Be blessed.